So now we begin with the plenary sessions. The first plenary session's themes will be water, water conservation and river rejuvenation, solid waste management, wastewater treatment, recycle and reuse. Now for this session, I would request Dr. Rajendra Singh ji to chair the session. Dr. Saukar is here, Dr. P.K. Pandey and Dr. A.D. Savan sir, who is a moderator. So I would request now Rajendra Singh ji to begin with the plenary session.
ये water crisis से climate change कैसे होता है और water crisis और climate का relation क्या है, इस पर बातचीत करने के लिए सबसे उपयुक्त व्यक्ति हमारे साथ पांडे जी हैं। तो पहले पांडे जी को सुनेंगे,
साहूकार जी को शायद प्रेजेंटेशन करना है।
अच्छा, तो सबसे पहले साहूकार जी को सुनेंगे। साहूकार जी एक बहुत ही सीनियर जियो हाइड्रोलॉजी सब कुछ हैं, धरती का पेट समझते जानते हैं। तो ये इनके प्रेजेंटेशन से ये सेशन शुरू करते हैं। तो स्टार्ट दिस प्रेजेंटेशन एंड तब तक मैं ये बता देना चाहता हूँ कि ये जो फाइव एलिमेंट हैं वाटर, जिसमें एक सबसे इम्पॉर्टेंट है, इस वाटर की केमिस्ट्री, वाटर केमिस्ट्री को जानने वाले लोग जानते हैं कि वाटर इस प्लैनेट के 119 तत्वों में से 90 तत्वों को अपने अंदर मिला लेता है। इतना बड़ा गुण जितना पानी के अंदर है, इतना किसी में नहीं है। इस हैं, हाँ, ये कह रहे हैं, ये उसका अंग्रेजी में नाम ले रहे हैं, जरा बोल दीजिए एक बार।
वाटर इज अ यूनिवर्सल सॉल्वेंट, सबको अंदर ले लेता है, समा लेता है।
तो ये वाटर केमिस्ट्री वाले ज़्यादा अच्छे से उसको बताएंगे, लेकिन मैं इतना जानता हूँ, मैं तो वाटर केमिस्ट्री का साइंटिस्ट नहीं हूँ, पर मैं जानता हूँ कि इस प्लेनेट पे 119 तत्व हैं। जैसे पंच महाभूत हुए ना, ये महाभूत, ये भूत हैं, 119 भूत एलिमेंट्स जिनको कहते हैं। ये जो 119 एलिमेंट्स हैं, इनमें से सर 90 एलिमेंट्स को ये अपन डिजोल्व कर लेता है। तो जिसके अंदर इतनी ताकत हो, वो क्या क्या बड़ी ताकत होगी। इसलिए मैं अब सीधे डायरेक्ट साहूकार जी को आमंत्रित करता हूँ।
अभी मैं डॉक्टर आर एच साहूकार, सेक्रेटरी जियोलॉजिकल सोसाइटी ऑफ इंडिया, बहुत बढ़िया काम करते हैं। उन्होंने उनका उनको आपने सुना ही है इनॉगरल सेशन में। ही विल बी गिविंग अस रियल साइंटिफिक प्रेजेंटेशन ऑन वाटर, वाटर कंजर्वेशन, रिवर रिजुविनेशन विद स्पेशल रेफरेंस टू कर्नाटका। लॉट्स हैव बीन स्टडीज हैव बीन डन इन द कर्नाटका ऑन द रिवर्स, एंड बिकॉज कर्नाटका इज द स्टेट विच इज वेरी केयरफुल ऑफ एग्रीकल्चरल कल्टिवेशंस, एंड इट इज द स्टेट वेर द एग्रेरियन कम्युनिटी इज वेरी वेरी स्ट्रांग, रायता महासंघ। सो रायता संघ एनफोर्सेस मेनी डिसीजन्स फॉर द डेवलपमेंट, सो दैट द एग्रीकल्चर इज नेवर पुट एट द बैक स्टेज, यू नो। दैट्स वाई इज गुड टू हैव हिम टू स्पीक ऑन द इशूज रिलेटेड टू कर्नाटका, विच ऑफकोर्स विल एनकॉम्पास एवरीथिंग ऑफ द रिवर्स ऑफ इंडिया। थैंक यू। प्लीज
आई हैव टू give you some idea about how these rivers were formed, what is the total water resources, and how to rejuvenate these rivers. And with reference to the peninsular India, I am going to give you some ideas how this is going to happen. Next one, please. Here you see 71 million years back, the India was connected with Australia and other things, and also the plate tectonics took place. And this was separated from Australia and moved towards the Asian plate at the rate of 2 centimeters per annum, and hit against the. Here you see this 71 million years old presentation. Then it is hit against the Australian Eurasian plate, and that is how Himalayan mountains were formed. It was suggested that Himalayan mountain formation were considered was only the mountain formations in that time of time. But subsequently, even in Deccan Plateau, it was considered as rising. This was moving horizontally like that, but the Deccan Plateau also started moving vertically also upward at a very, very slow rate. Next one. You see here what we have shown in the first Plato, second Plato, third Plato and fourth Plato. These were rising at a very periodical time of Gondwana times, post-Cretaceous times and tertiary periods. These were the different periods at which the things were elevated. You see on the western part, the dark portions, you see that they are all western Sahyadri hill ranges. This is the water divide line what we are seeing here. So the majority of the water that falls on the Sahyadri hill range goes towards the west only. To the east there is also goes, but major rivers carry this water here also. How this has to be equitably distributed, we have to look into it. So what is most important point what you have to observe in this this one is, you see the rivers like the Sharavati and other things, they were originally flowing towards the east, but they have been captured and diverted to the west. That is because of the very heavy rainfall on the western Sahyadri, and these are captured because what we call as headward erosion. So this entire resources of water which was originally flowing to the east has been diverted to the west. So similarly, Kali River, Gangavali River and all these things, this was the ridge line, you see, and because of the erosion and these gaps, these have been captured. This is what is necessary to understand from the point of what total water resources. They are, of course, they are all pre-Vedic times. It is difficult to imagine these things unless you go back to the geological concepts. Next one. Here, what I have tried to see is, here I have tried to show, you see, basins, you know, the first basin, second basin is Krishna basin, which is the largest one, third is the Kaveri basin, and seventh is the Western Ghats. What do you see in the Western Ghat? You see, I will show you in terms of the, I will only refer in terms of the Karnataka. If you look at this, Karnataka has got 3,400 TMC of water. Out of this 3,400 TMC of water, you see about 2,000 TMC of water goes in this seven, that is the western Arabian Sea only. The remaining one, which goes about 1,400, goes towards the Bay of Bengal. It only means there is a large quantity of water that is flowing. Originally, Captain Dastur and others formulated a canal so that you can divert all this water at the higher level and produce power, and with the power of generation you can achieve whatever that is possible. Even today the Koyna River is, you see, Tata electricity power is also generated by diverting that river. So this is a very important factor which we have to see. We don't want to put a direct canal for all these things which was possessed by Paramsivaya, one of the civil engineer. But as a geologist and geomorphologist and geographers, we have tried to identify some areas like Mahanadi, Badati, Ghataprabha, all these things, where these originally were flowing to the east, they have been diverted to the west. These points you can lift the water and bring it to the eastern drainage. This is what we are trying to tell in this, point out this to the planners or administrators or whomsoever. This is one. Next one. You see here, what we see here is the, on the yellow side is the western drainage pattern, and the Krishna is shown as a larger one, and this one. You see this yellow portion on the right side, what you see is all the drought prone areas. They get a very low rainfall area, and these can be diverted from some of these rivers which I showed you earlier, which can be diverted. So on the top of it, you see, we have shown from which RL to which RL you can divert this. Only 10 meters and 20 meters left lift you can get it. You will get a very large quantity of water which can be diverted to the east. So you can identify several places like that in the Western Ghat on a detailed examination and all this. This is what we have to remember. Next one. You see here, what we have tried to project here is the, how the water flows takes place. On the top of it, you see on the top of it is the open wells there. So open wells, you know, they will were originally used. Then subsequently, bore wells came into a picture. So they started developing, and further one, the rich people started the deeper wells, and they are now dewatering what we call as a fossil water, which is dated at 60,000 years or 70,000 years. That is what we originally thought as a geologist. But in recent times, they are trying to identify that there are waters which are 2 million years old, 1 million years old also. This is the recent reporting of the what is the age of waters and all that. This is a very important point which you have to see. In the bottom, if you come to see, in the 10,000 years back, there was some sort of a oasis. And today, there is a small quantity of water in the that one. So in the today's position, that will also be going away. And in the future, in the future days also, the Krishna water also will, there will be no underflow in the Krishna, overflow in the Krishna also. So that will also become a barren area. So why it is all becoming? That is because of the over-exploitation of this water level. You can show it. Water level here, on that water level there. You see, there, that is what happens in that water level. Because the water level have been going down very rapid rate, the overflow is not able to percolate and discharge into the water. In the rainy season, most of the water goes as a overflow or a flood flow and all that. That is what we have to say. You have to take into account, if you want to really rejuvenate the waters, you have to divide the entire basins into a basin, sub-basin, macro-basin, micro-basin, first-order and second-order streams, and where to arrest water, where suitable structures are there, geologically as well as topographically. This is a very important point from the understanding. And this has to be controlled and in such a way that that basin people will utilize only that quantity of water which can be discharged. They should not utilize more than that. This has to be regularly planned and all that. Although many state governments have started developing watershed and they have divided the entire state into a watershed. But what they do is they do not develop this watershed systematically. Wherever there is an influence, they start developing it, which I will show you in the later slide. Next one. You see, here I have tried to project what is the total water resources that are available in excess and what is it. Total quantity of water is about 12,000, you can show. 12,254 TMC is the total water what you can see from this peninsular India. And out of that, excess available is 4,084. This is estimated by one of the geologists, who is Vaidyanathan, who has written this Landforms of India, which is a very famous book and all that. So that is again validated from the point of view of a sociologist, A. Vaidyanathan. And he has also estimated there is a sufficient quantity of water available in this basin, which can be redistributed for the entire peninsular India rivers. But how to do it and how to make equitable distribution of water, because that is the one point which Rajendra Singh ji has been saying, that there has to be an equitable distribution of water. We understand this equitable distribution of water, but where it is very easy to do surface water. But when it comes to a groundwater, there is a relationship between the groundwater as well as deep this one. When the groundwater is owned by a landowner, he can put any deep wells and see that the surrounding well become defunct or not able to yield any water. So it ultimately depends upon the individual prosperity of the area. And I want to bring it to your all notice that the government always helps to build dams and other things at a very total cost and all that. But if you total take the entire statistics of India, the rain-fed area and groundwater area irrigates 75% of the total this one. So that is not financially supported by this for rain-fed area and groundwater. This is one of the important factor which we'll have to notice it. And there has to be a financial equitable distribution of finances for rain-fed and also groundwater, in relation to what they are doing for dams and other things also. Next one. You see, here I told you how diversion takes place. This is a Sharavati river. You see the ridge here, which goes like that, you know. And if that was originally flowing like that, and now they have built a dam there and they are diverting it and they are utilizing it, power generation and all that. What we are saying is power can be generated everywhere, anywhere. But water cannot be generated. So whatever is the excess water that goes into the Arabian Sea, you divert it to a fall diversion in this red patches which I have shown, and it can be diverted to this east flowing rivers. This is what is important from this point of view to understand how drainages help, study of drainages help in identifying suitable places where the western west flowing rivers can be easily diverted to the east to feed to the drought prone areas. Next one. You see, this is the great Mahadayi dispute, what is between Goa and Karnataka. You see, and as a matter of fact, we arranged a trip led by this Rajendra Singh ji, and our this one is also here. So he is also here. Kishore Dharia ji, he is also here. So he arranged a Konkan Parikrama starting from Mumbai up to Goa and all that. So we explained what is the difference between the coastal area geomorphology and the upland geomorphology. So we tried to explain them, we have to adopt a different methods and all that. There is enough water that is available and all that. But at the end in Goa, before Goa, Maharashtra ministers came and Karnataka ministers came. Rajendra Singh ji also came, but the Goa minister did not report. So there is a possibility of solving these things amicably. This is what we have to estimate correctly, how much is the water that is required to go into the Arabian Sea. You see, the total water resources, what is estimated according to the world standards, see, 40% of the total resources of that area can be led into a Arabian Sea. For example, in Karnataka, we get about 2000 TMC of water goes into the Arabian Sea. So out of this 2000 TMC of total water that goes, you can take about 40%, that's about 800 TMC. So the other 1200 TMC of water can be diverted to the east to charge these drought areas and all that. One of the most important factors which we have committed faults is, earlier we built a Bhadra ram on a forest area. So instead of diverting that water to the drought areas and all that, we deforested the area and gave it to a cultivation and all that. This is another important factor which we have to see what our faults are there. Even in Maharashtra also, as I told you, that Maharashtra has got the very largest number of dams in India. And 4% of the agricultural land in Maharashtra uses 75% of the total water resources. And most of them are grown as sugar. What we show, what we declare, sugar cane amounts to export of water. So what we are pleading with the government or other people is, in simple terms, to say, if you produce 1 kg of sugar, you have to charge about 100 rupees for that sugar growing. And if it is a millet and jowar and all that, they use only 5 rupees water. So you give 95 rupees as support price to these jowar people and all that. That will solve the problem, and that will keep the sugar growing people in the proper order. These are some of the social problems which we cannot solve. We can only indicate where the water is there, how it can be utilized. It is for people like Rajendra Singh ji and professor and all these people who can take to a higher level and see that there is some equitable distribution, it takes place. Next one. You see here what I have tried to show, how it can be diverted on the left side. You see, by only 10 meter leftly and 0.5 kilometer length, you can produce a large quantity of water for the entire area, which is shown down below. Here it is shown. You see, all these things can be divided into, next one, can be divided into blocks and all that, where there are watersheds and all that. How to develop these watersheds and how drainage has to be developed and what drainage has to be developed on priority, and all this has to be worked out. You see, there is a feasibility of working out all these things and see, to some extent, equitable distribution is possible. It is not that equitable distribution is possible for everybody, but it is possible to do it, provided the certain relationship, legal relationship is established between the land and the water. Particularly land, when it belongs to a private fellow, he can take it the deeper boreholes and all that. Water should be considered as a mineral, as a natural resources, and it should be shared equitably in that society. This is what Taruna Bharat Sangh has been propagating, and I do hope that it will be done. Next one. I think it will be here what we have plotted is, there is one project called Sujala Project, where we have given that in the left side we have given a picture, and that is how we have divided it. And ultimately, when we come to the right side here, we divide it into a survey number, where the local survey numbers can be identified. And that survey number, whether there is a borewell, what is the crop pattern that is now projecting, and all that can be plotted it. This is how it has been done, a Sujala project and all that. Next one. You see here, what we have done is, again, as I told you earlier, we have lifted about 20 meters here and put it into the eastern drainage. Whatever is the excess water can be easily taken out here. There are many problems which can be solved if all the scientists put together their this one, including the civil engineers. Civil engineers know only how to make dams and how to divert it and all that. But they have to take into account the groundwater and also how it can be charged and utilized throughout the year and all that. And how rivers can be rejuvenated. Next one. You see here, as I told you earlier, on the left side you have got that Sahyadri Hill Range. The entire peninsula of India is there. And if you look at the geographic area, it forms only 12% of the total peninsula of India, but it gets 75% of the rainfall. In terms of the precipitation of the rainfall also, if you see in Sahyadri, it precipitated at the rate of 2.88 BCM per square kilometer area. But if you come to the eastern side, in the plains and all that, it precipitated at the rate of 0.88 BCM per square kilometer area. This is the unequitable distribution by nature, of course, but the Sahyadri water, when it flows here, it can be equitably distributed between the to keep the minimum flow that is required for the ocean, and also to divert the remaining flow towards the eastern. So this is what I have tried to, here what we have tried to see is, we have to redefine what is the water resources. Water resources, so far we have been defining only in terms of the surface water and to some extent groundwater. These are all what we are we try to plan on these things. But what we have to see is the atmospheric water. Whether how much is the water is there in the atmosphere has to be seen. Then the surface water. How much is there in the surface water? And how much is there in the groundwater? Groundwater here. Groundwater. And all these three, after that, you get what is, as you go down below, as we told you, in the water, the source of water is in the second column, here in that. In the second column, you see the source of water is from icy comet, meteorites, and rocks of the earth. So now it is established that the rocks of the earth also contribute to a large extent the water. When it goes down below a particular level and all that, it gets evaporated. This is what we have projected the oceans, and oceans, in the oceans also there are mountains. So that is what is, even the ancient people also, they say these things, you see, ancient, this one also. So you have got a Pacific Ocean and a Pacific Ridge also, Atlantic Ocean and depth also, and sea spreads are there. And these mountains, this water always travels on these things. And sometimes when it gets heated up by a temperature, it rises to the surface. Whether this is equitably established, whether it can be. One way the controversy is always between the two scientists also. I can't say there is no controversy between the scientists also. Some people say, no, you can't differentiate. But what I have shown in 5, we can show. Isotopic age determination of the seawater distillate will prove or disprove the claim of the seawater distillate to supply water on a sustainable basis to a rate of 1.5 lakhs to a. So this is one of the proposal to see whether there is a possibility of doing it. The second is the atmosphere required, how to have to recover it, and surface water and groundwater. While the atmospheric water and seawater will become resources, but the surface water and the groundwater becomes reserves. So we have always said that on the linking of rivers, we are against that. But we can link small portions of the rivers where there is excess water to a deficit basins. So, and store that in a suitable, geologically suitable places. This is what I thought. Next one. You see, this is what is what I told as atmospheric water, surface water, groundwater, and ocean water. These all have to be distributed. And the first one and the fourth one will become a resources, whereas the surface water and groundwater become reserves. So how to distribute these reserves equitably is another point again. Next one. It is a thanks only. You see, here what I try to point out is they are trying to make, you see, always the government wants a big projects where there is a large money and all that. They have got a money from Linganmakki Reservoir, which I showed you, Sharavati Reservoir. They want it up, pump it up to 525, another money reservoir. From there, they want to pump it up to Yagachi Reservoir, which is about 980 meters. Then it comes to a gravity to Bangalore. So all the way, the project cost is about 60,000 crores of rupees. And the political people sitting in Bangalore and all that, they try to influence this type of projects. And another one is reservoir and sea level and city drinking water problems. So they made a presentation before the Bangalore Water Supply Minister also. They said that a large dam can be built in the sea itself to to see that the soft water gets accumulated there and pump it to the surface. It is true also. I am not saying it is not true, but it is for a place like Netherlands or small islands. It is possible. But for a country like India where people are suffering, I don't think these are some of the proposals which you can take. The best proposal is arrest water where it falls and utilize it, store it underground and utilize it safely. Don't allow it to be exploited by a sun. Sun chori karta hai karke hamara Rajendra Singh ji sab bolta rata hai. So this is what, next one. You see, this is what he has already explained all these things to you. I don't have to explain and he will do it. I thank you very much for giving all this opportunity to explain this. Only thing I can tell you, if properly utilized, there will be no dispute of water, either Kaveri or Godavari or any other things, it can be solved. Only thing is people have to be understood and administration has to understand and it has to be implemented. I do hope that a proper resolution or a declaration will be made so that the equitable world comes into a picture. Thank you very much.
साथियों से सुझाव ये है कि सवाल जवाब का वक्त नहीं है, हम लोग अगले वक्ता को सुनेंगे, लेकिन जो डिक्लेरेशन लिख रहे हैं उन्हें खास ध्यान देना है कि इस प्रेजेंटेशन में सदर्न इंडिया में जो वाटर क्राइसिस है, मैं जानता हूँ ये हमेशा लिंकिंग ऑफ द रिवर का बहुत घोर विरोध करते रहे हैं, लेकिन इन्होंने आज एक लिंकिंग ऑफ द रिवर सजेस्ट किया. व्हाट इज द रीजन व्हाई ही सजेस्ट? आई अंडरस्टैंड व्हाई ही सजेस्ट, बिकॉज दिस इज द लिंकिंग ऑफ द रिवर इज नॉट फॉर डिजास्टर, बिकॉज द ऑल लिंकिंग ऑफ द रिवर फॉर द डिजास्टर फॉर द ए बिग वाटर ट्रांसफर टू द बिग सिटीज, बिग इंडस्ट्रीज, बिग 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 बिग. Lekin here he suggests a very poorest of the poor part of this country in water. And that region before this river flowing that side, so there is the sufficient water before. But now this river changed the flow side because due to the erosion. Due to the erosion changed the flow. And that water is not coming in the that side. So he says just justice of nature. He is not speaking in the favor of the linking of the river. So isko koi confuse na kare. Isliye ye clarify kar raha hu. He is never advocating the linking of the river. But and diversion. He is never favor in the diversion. But he is saying the before this is the natural flow that side. So now the need for the poorest of the poor part of this country, if we can make a old flow system in that side. So just clarify this presentation. Dosto, ye samajhna bahut zaruri hai कि जब हम प्रकृति के साथ अन्याय करते हैं तो मानवता के साथ अन्याय होता है, जब हम प्रकृति में न्याय करते हैं तो मानवता से भी न्याय होता है। तो मानवता और प्रकृति का न्याय दोनों का जुड़ा हुआ है। इसलिए ये जो केस साहूकार जी प्रेजेंट कर रहे थे, ये मानवता और प्रकृति दोनों को न्याय मिले वैसी बात कर रहे थे। थैंक यू
पांडे जी, प्लीज द नेक्स्ट प्रेजेंटेशन। आई एम श्योर दैट द प्रेजेंटेशन बाय डॉक्टर सावकार हैज बीन वेल अंडरस्टूड बाय अस फॉर दोज हु आर एक्शन पीपल, यू नो आई विल कमेंट ऑन दैट लेटर ऑन। लेट डॉक्टर पांडे बिगिन विद हिज लेक्चर। Meanwhile, I'll continue my comments. He has said that how that yellow zone can be made a blue zone. Are you ready? So, and the map showing the ground realities. He has gone one step further to determine the age of the water, including seawater, where the drains come from the land to the sea, and then with the isotopic labeling of the compound, the great technology for even geological water quantity estimation, we never heard that it can be used for weight determination with isotopes in the water in the sea. And that's a beautiful suggestions. I think any Aayog, Niti and whatever it is, will have to think very seriously about this. You have quantified the amount of water, about 4,000 TMCs from Maharashtra, 2,000 each from the Goa and Karnataka and Kerala. So this vast water, after saturating the river basins, going to the sea, instead it can be diverted to the drought-prone area. I think entire south problem can be solved to those rivers originating and more from the western ghat, right? And the ideology that more the aquifer storage will be more useful than thinking of the very, I would say, the mad idea of making a dam into the sea, right? Thank you.
However, so as it is said by Dr. Rajan Singh ji, prakriti ke saath nyay. So in that process, I'm trying to take you prakriti ke saath nyay, that is bioremediation, a tool to combat aquatic pollution. So it means before disposing of the effluents, if we treat it properly and especially using either plants or fungi or bacteria, so that will be a natural kind of the treatment before disposal of the effluents to the river, sea, wherever. As we all are well aware, that most of the cities are located either on the bank of the rivers or in the coastal belts. So obviously whatever effluents are generated, domestic sewage as well as industrial sewage, everything is being dumped in the water bodies. Or whatever, in other words, if I say whatever effluents are being generated, ultimately it is finding the place to the water bodies. So that is the idea, that if we treat it properly. So here I start with ever increasing human population, urbanization and industrialization cause increase in the level of complex toxic effluents into the global environment. As the population is increasing, not only that, all of you are well aware that population is migrating from the rural areas to the cities. So that is also increasing the load on the cities, and in turn it generates a lot of effluents. Not only that, as our lifestyle is changing, we need more of the comforts, we need more of the number of air conditioners, we need more of the refrigerators, we need more of the shampoos. So all these are generating a lot of effluents. Energy consumption is increasing. So these effluents needs to be treated properly. Now, as we all are aware about the Bhopal gas tragedy in 1984, which has happened, isocyanide, which killed many people over there. this Union Carbide Bhopal disaster, over 5 lakhs people were exposed to methyl isocyanide gas and other chemicals, 3,787 deaths related to gas. Exxon Valdez oil spills we keep on hearing in the sea, that causes a lot of damage to the aquatic organisms. So this is one of the example. Sandoz chemical spills in Switzerland. So this is another example. Worldwide problem of pollutions. This is all the effluents generated over the worldwide. Especially in India, we have more of these problems, as cleanliness is a major problem. Our people are not so used to. We are so happy dumping the things here and there. In fact, I will tell you one story. In 1995, I went to Bangkok. So I used to smoke. So after smoking, I found the city so neat and clean that it was very difficult for me to throw the last part, which is left one. So I used to carry it for 5 minutes to 10 minutes in my hand to find a dustbin. And I was there hardly for 1 month. And when I came back to India, the most beautiful airport of Mumbai, supposedly most beautiful, at least in India, it was looking so dirty to me that I was wondering that within 1 month, when I am thinking that it is so dirty, so when the people who are coming from other part of the world, when they say India is dirty, so they are not exaggerating. So that's the kind of level. While when I was there, so even after eating banana, the pills which we carry, that also they collect in some bag and throw it at a proper place later on. And here we are quite happy if I do not throw in my own house, if I dump it out from my window or even from my car window. So that's the level. So we need to create a lot of awareness among our people that whatever we are doing, you can see the fish kill, fish mortality, this mangroves, even that is also devastated. Degraded water in environmental context represents degeneration of water quality following its original intended use, domestic, agriculture, industrial, and so on. So actually, whatever, if you see, we have 97% of saline water, only 3% fresh water we have, which is to be used for irrigation purpose, for livestock, for human beings, consumption, taking bath, whatever. And out of this 3%, again, most of that is in the form of snow, ice. That is on Himalaya, it is lying. So that is also not available. Again, a very small portion of that is available. So it means we have to use this water in a very, very precise manner, very, very systematic manners. And the great example is of Israel. Israel does not have even sufficient water for drinking purpose. They are desalinizing the sea water. They are using it. And they have developed such a beautiful micro-irrigation facility that they are using it for the irrigation purpose. So only they are using that much water as much is required by particular crop. So there is no wastage. Not only that, in fact, they are exporting to the neighboring countries. While in India we have so much water and still we are short of water and we are saying we are scarce in the water, the reason being we are not using it properly. If we use it properly, probably there will not be any need of linking up the rivers, diversion of the rivers and so on. Because when we are talking about the linking of the rivers, diversion of the rivers, one very, very important aspect which we are not taking into account, nobody is taking into account, that is biodiversity, ecological aspects. Because that is one of the very important aspects. As few minutes back, while speaking from the dais, I said, when Green Revolution came, we thought the problem of the food in this country is solved. But later on, we have realized that most of the land in Punjab, Haryana, it has become alkaline, it has become saline, it is no more suitable for agriculture purpose. Now we are thinking back, where we went wrong, what went wrong. Now, you will not believe the farmers in Punjab, they are having two kind of wheat cultivation. One they are cultivating for their own consumption, one they are cultivating for selling in the market. Are you aware? See, in 1 hectare, they will cultivate the wheat which they are not going to eat them. Which they are going to eat themselves. They are not putting insecticides, they are not putting pesticides and so on. And in remaining, maybe in 9 hectares and so on, they will grow for the marketing purpose. This is the kind of scenario which is existing. It means, over the period of time, you are becoming conscious, and that's good. It's not bad, it's good. But it's better that we take into account all the problems as quickly as possible. How the water gets degraded, anthropogenic affluences, natural phenomenon are also there. So we don't have much control on natural phenomenon, but then definitely we can control as far as anthropogenic influences are concerned. And if we take the case of India, you know, a lot of organic waste, sewage, pesticides, then plastics. Plastics you can see even in Mumbai, in and around Warsaw Beach, Juhu, and all that, full of plastic beach. Recently, some organization or one individual has been working very well. Amitabh Bachchan joined and they have probably cleaned the 7 Bangalore and Warsaw Beach. Then apart from that, oil problem, then all the pesticides, insecticides, all these we have been dumping indiscriminately in our agriculture system. And as I said in the beginning, that all these pesticides, insecticides, fertilizers, whatever we are adding, ultimately all these residues are coming to the water bodies. Maybe it is coming to the adjacent rivers, from rivers it is going to the Arabian Sea, Bay of Bengal, Indian Ocean and so on. So if we correct it then and there are two types of the pollution. If we try to categorize it, one is point source, another one is non-point source. When I say point source, it means it is originating from one particular point, so we can see it, we can control it. Non-point means agriculture we are doing. We are using the fertilizers, insecticides, pesticides. So it is just flowing and it is going. So it is not originating from one particular point. But if there is an industry, so whatever effluents are being generated, that is coming from one particular point. So that can be treated, maybe using plants wherein Neeri has done work, she has done some work, maybe using the bacteria which we have done some of the work, where we have done the work with respect to the leather industry. Leather industry, as you might be aware, it is located Agra, Kanpur, Chennai. So in the leather industry processing, they are using the chromate for its processing purpose. So in the effluents we are getting a lot of chromium. So we have tried wherein there are certain bacteria which are capable of converting hexavalent chromium into trivalent. So hexavalent chromium is more toxic to the aquatic animals, while trivalent is not that toxic. So there are certain bacteria. So what I am trying to say, even in the plants, many aquatic plants are there which are capable of absorbing these even heavy metals, many of the chromium, many even radioactive compounds also can be absorbed. But then problem comes with respect to the plants. What do we do with these plants? Say, they have absorbed chromium, they have absorbed arsenic, they have absorbed lead. But then ultimately it has got only transformed from water to the plant. Now that lead remains in the plant. What do we do with that plant? Either it is to be eaten by some animal, or maybe some human beings, even aquatic plants, or we are going to dump again somewhere. So only we are changing the place, maybe from one aquatic water body to the land, maybe from one aquatic body to another water body. But then there are certain bacteria which can convert it into either in a lesser toxic form or maybe a non-toxic form. If we use that kind of the facility, that kind of the arrangement, so that's natural, and then it is not transforming from one place to another place. So what I am trying to tell during this my discussion, that my focus is on the point source of pollution, wherever it is generating from the particular industry, wherever industries are there, so we can have some kind of the bioremediation systems. Because here I would like to tell one thing, just to understand in general. As we all know, that bacteria is ubiquitous. Ubiquitous means it is omnipresent. It is present everywhere. If I say it is like God, as God is present everywhere, bacteria is also present everywhere. It is present on Himalaya. It is present even deep down. So, what I am trying to emphasize, once bacteria is present everywhere, so it means some bacteria which loves the cold, it is found in the cold region. Someone which loves high pressure, that is found at the bottom of the sea. Some bacteria which loves the high temperature, that is found in the deserts. Some bacteria which love salt, they are found in the salt. So what I mean to say, all sorts of bacteria are there. Some of them love cold regions, some of them love hot regions, some of them love the alkaline regions. So we need to isolate those bacteria. There must be some reason, some specific reason that they love to be there. So we have to isolate from that particular location. Now to simplify it, I will say, say for example, if you want to treat a leather industry, so you have to look for the bacteria which have the bioremediating capacity from the effluents which is coming out from the leather industry itself. It means you have to go to Kanpur, you have to go to Agra, you have to go to Chennai, where the leather is being processed. And you have to isolate those bacteria from the effluents which is generated from those industries. Same is applicable for any effluents. This is for example I told. There can be lead industry, arsenic. Arsenic is a problem in the states of West Bengal, in some parts of Maharashtra, even Jalgaon and that area, even in Bangladesh. So if you have to look, if you have to bioremediate the arsenic content which is present even in the drinking water, so we must isolate from them, we try to grow them, we try to culture them, we try to upscale them so that we can use it for the bioremediation purpose. This is the nutshell I am trying to say. And then when it comes to the practicality, what can we do? We can, this already I have spoken, we can simply, wherever industrial effluents are coming out, at that point we can have some kind of the arrangement, we can make some pits. Maybe even we can use the phytoremediation wherever plants I was telling. So maybe some major elements will be removed by the plants. When we pass on from one pit to another pit, there we can use, there we can introduce certain bacteria. Now again, when I am talking this, any particular kind of the pollutants, it does not exist in isolation. What I am trying to say, when I said leather industry, chromium is a problem. But it does not mean if you take the case of Ganga or Yamuna at Agra or Kanpur, it is only chromium. There can be some other metals, there can be some other pollutants which is also coming. So first of all, we have to find out at that particular site what are the pollutants, what are the contaminants which are existing there. And then we have to develop the consortia of the bacteria. So now say for example, we have found out zinc is also there, lead is also there, arsenic is also there, chromium is also there. So individually you try to isolate the bacteria, maybe by enriching with zinc. Normal water, you take the normal water, put the high level of the zinc, allow it to be there for few days, then isolate whatever bacteria are existing. Because its logic is simple, science is simple, that only those bacteria will remain there which will love to be there in the presence of higher level of the zinc or cobalt or lead. And those bacteria which will not love to have the zinc, they will obviously disappear. So you can isolate those bacteria, you can try to culture it, you can try to upscale it, you can try to culture it in large scale so that its multiplication technique can be developed and then it can be applied. So now likewise zinc, lead, arsenic, chromium, all four you have developed. Now, since all four are present in a particular site, so you have to see there may be three bacteria, four bacteria which are capable of reducing, say, chromium. Or maybe they are in position to convert from hexavalent chromium to trivalent chromium. But then they may not be compatible with other bacteria which is capable of reducing or bioremediating lead. So we have then next step will be to check the compatibility, whether it is compatible or not. So likewise, we have to see the compatibility with all three, four contaminants or pollutants which is existing. Then we can develop, we can come out with a consortia which is suitable for the bioremediation of a particular site, depending upon the contaminants which is existing there. And same may not be applicable as it is applicable in Agra, same may not be applicable at Aligarh, same may not be applicable at Chennai. That will differ again depending upon the kind of contaminants and pollutants which is existing over there. Then bioremediation, you know, I need not talk much. Then we can have it in situ or ex situ also, both the way. In situ means at the site itself we can practice it, as I was narrating. Or in certain cases, maybe especially solid waste, semi-solid waste, it can be removed from the site, it can be taken in some bioreactors and wherein maybe bacteria, or ultimately bacteria means what? It is the enzyme of the bacteria which is responsible. So if you can develop some kind of the mechanisms and some kind of the technology to produce the particular enzyme which is responsible for the degradation or bioremediation, and if you add that enzyme, that way also it can be done. Then these are the different kind of the groups of the enzymes which are responsible. May not be relevant that I talk in so much detail. Oxidoreductase, transferase, hydrolases, isases, isomerases, ligases, and so on. Why use bioremediation? Because no additional disposal cost, no side effects, low maintenance, it does not create an eyesore, capable of impacting source zones and thus decreasing site cleanup time. But here, there are many external factors that also has to be taken. So when I am telling all this, definitely it cannot be done immediately, it cannot be done by the normal persons. But a lot of R&D is required. But if we have to maintain it on a sustainable basis, this R&D has to be done either by government or maybe those private organizations which are involved in producing the effluents. They should do it. They should come out with the solution so that sustainable kind of the mechanism can be developed for the bioremediation of these sites. These are the different processes. Either it can transform it, as I said, that from hexavalent it can convert into trivalent, or it can biodegrade it so that it becomes non-toxic completely. It can convert into less toxic. This is the history which I am not going in detail. But here there is a possibility of genetic manipulation also. Suppose some particular bacteria is there which is capable of degrading, for example, lead. It means there must be some particular gene which is responsible for the biodegradation of lead. By using the genetic engineering tool, if you can identify, if you can characterize what that particular gene is there, so the same gene can be incorporated in other organisms so that they also become capable of degrading it. It needs the substrates for its growth. As I said that it will love cold region. Suppose some bacteria is there which loves salt. So it means we have to provide the salt as a source for its growth. It starts it so that it will start growing. This is all the requirement, electron acceptor, carbon energy. Achha, why it is degrading? Why it is bioremediating? It is not that bacteria want to clean the environment for us. It is because bacteria want to use that particular kind of the contaminant as a source of energy, as a source of nutrient for its own growth, survival, multiplication. That is the reason. It means we have to provide the kind of food the bacteria love to have. Once it gets that kind of food, automatically it will start reproducing, it will start multiplying, and we will have more of the numbers. then there can be aerobic or anaerobic biodegradation, that is in presence of oxygen, in absence of oxygen. So that also has to be seen, because the site where we are going to apply, if it is anaerobic conditions, and if you put the aerobic bacteria, aerobic fungi, that is not going to be of any use. This is the metabolism. I am not going to talk in situ versus ex situ. These are some of the processes by which we can enhance the process. Bioventing, as I said, suppose most of our aquatic environment, because top layer is aerobic in nature, but if there is a deficiency of the oxygen, or if you want to make the multiplication much faster, so we have to provide the bioventing, that is maybe oxygenation if it is possible, that is one of the possibility. Biospurging involves the injection of air under pressure, because if it is deep down, there under pressure we have to provide the oxygen. Bioaugmentation. What is bioaugmentation? Involves practice of adding specialized microbes. Maybe in some particular site that microbes are not present, then we can culture it in the lab conditions, and then we can introduce so that it starts multiplying. That is your bioaugmentation. This is all the detail I have given. Then this bioreactors, as I told, that is ex situ. We can take out, if suppose some semi-solid kind of the, some effluents are there, it can be treated and then it can be put it back. Maybe we can add the bacteria, maybe we can add the enzymes. This is the treatment systems which can be employed for this. This remediation of oil spills also can be done. Whatever this oil spills are happening, because most of the oil is being transported through sea and a lot of oil spill are happening, which is harmful to the animals, fish. It is not only fish, actually when we talk in general, we talk about fish. But then there are plankton, there are bacteria, whole lot of the bacteria are there, which is involved in the biogeochemical cycles, which is converting your nitrite to nitrate and so on, otherwise ammonia will be much higher, which will lead to the problem. Want to finish? I'll finish it. Just you can see the picture, how the oil complete emulsification has taken place on the top layer. Then heavy metal degradation also can be done using these techniques. These are some of the bacteria which has been used for arsenic, cadmium, chromium, mercury and so on for its degradation. These are the name I have given, and genetically engineered bacteria are also there. Phytoremediation already I have spoken, if you use the plant, but then problem is it takes into the leaves, it takes into the plant, stem everywhere, then it's dumping and reuse is a problem. But then that is also being used. Then these are the problems, fish mortality, even more of the algae. These are some suitable aquatic plants which can be used for phytoremediation. Duckweed, you might have seen some floating weeds on the surface of the water bodies. That is also very good for the removal of the heavy metal and other pollutants, even nutrients, nitrogen, phosphorus and so on. What are the advantages of bioremediation? Bioremediation can degrade waste materials in reasonably short time. No adverse effects when used correctly. It helps in removing toxic components from oil, wastewater, etc. Simple and more through approach than mechanical technology. Relatively less costly. What are the limitations? Its effectiveness may depend on type of waste pollutants. So unless until we judge what kind of pollutants are existing in a particular site, its use may not be suitable. May not be convenient during heavy rains. Because when heavy rains are there, your concentration will get diluted. May require 2 to 3 periodic spraying of nutrient depending upon the density of spilled oil in case of spilled oil bioremediation. So many times what happens, after putting these bacteria, we are not very sure, because we cannot see by our naked eye whether it is multiplying or not. We may not check it periodically to find out that what are the external sources which is existing, maybe in terms of abiotic and biotic factors, whether it is favorable for the growth of bacteria or not. So these are some of the lacuna, and then we need to go a long way. Still a lot of research, R&D has to be done so that we come out with a solutions which is suitable to a particular agroclimatic zone and maybe depending upon the kind of the problem and contaminant which is existing. Maybe we can go with a kind of suggestion that all these industries which are having, they should have this kind of the bioremediation kind of arrangement in place so that before the disposal of the effluents into the water body, because most of these industries are located near to some or other water body, they must imply that instead of having that STP, whatever sewage treatment plant and other things are existing. Thank you very much for patient hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Pandey, for the wonderful lecture and the kind of scientific practice that can be done by everybody, every common small industry or households. It takes care of sewages, it takes care of the toxic chemicals going into effluents. So it depends where you apply it. ये तो एक साधा तरीका है कि जो कैप्चर्ड पानी है, जैसे सावकार साहब ने बताया कि एक्सेस वाटर को कैसे यूटिलाइज किया जाए फॉर ड्रॉट प्रोन, लेकिन व्हाट अबाउट द कैप्चर्ड वाटर, इसका बहुत हानि हो रही है. और ये रिसाइकल रीयूज तो बड़ा तकनीकी है, बट ये जो नीरी ने टेक्नोलॉजी डेवलप किया है, डॉक्टर पांडे एंड ऑल अदर्स, एक तो ये उनका एक स्पेशल ब्रांड रहा है नीरी का, डॉक्टर टंडन इज हियर, फाइटो रेमिडिएशन, बड़े बड़े कॉम्प्लेक्सेस में इसका अगर यूज़ के गांव में भी यूज़ किया जा सकता है. तो सीवेज पानी जो है जो इकट्ठा होके उसको अगर ये फाइटो रेमिडिएशन प्लांट्स प्लान बनाएं, तो जो बाहर जाएगा तो काफ़ी अच्छा पानी रहेगा, विच कैन बी यूज फॉर all kind of purposes, agriculture purposes, gardens, watering plants, orchards and everything. It also contains a good number of nutrients. Khali we have to take care that it does not have toxic chemicals. Agar hai to remediate karke wo pani, usme na to lead hai na chromium and cadmium, but these problems of heavy metal contamination come from industries. तो इंडस्ट्रियल पोल्यूशन जो होता है काफ़ी लैंड स्पॉइल भी होता है, उसके लिए तो बढ़िया तरीका है फाइटो रेमिडिएशन, बायो रेमिडिएशन. और मैं तो पूना की मीटिंग में बताया था कि सारी जो स्लम्स एरियाज हैं वो पानी मुला मुठा में न जाए डायरेक्टली, वहाँ यूट्रिफिकेशन हो रहा है, पूरा पानी का कवर बन जाता है, ऑल द वाटर इज कवर्ड बाय वाटर हाइसिंथ, सो देर इज़ नो ऑक्सीजन डिजोल्यूशन. Aquatic species, they die because of suffocation. Powai lake ka bhi jo hai, jo kafi tarike se usko weed nikalna padta hai. So these practices are very simple. It does not require a big science. Only Neeri should publish the list of plants. The plants are very specific. Even before that, engineered, you know, genetically engineered. The specific plants will take specific heavy metals. Lead, cadmium, zinc, chromium and all that. So where this kind of pollutions are there, this can be practiced by very common man. Sewage pani ke liye bhi use kar sakte hain. Aur ye jhopadpatti ka pani hai, slums ka hai, jo directly rivers mein jata hai, Ranjendra ji, ye to bade bade aapka plantation ka jo proposal hai river belts mein. But the sewage which goes to the cities, city sewages, where the rivers are flowing through the cities. Mula Mutha is an ideal example of that. Ulas Kalu, when they flow through the township, all this, and Mithi River, it comes through. Such sewage should not be allowed to go directly to the rivers, but should be at least treated by phytoremediations in a community pool. So, इसे 90% pollution कम हो जाएगा. The rivers can rejuvenate faster. But I don't know why this simple technology cannot be applied to. हमारे university of Mumbai was not getting sufficient water for our gardens of 42 acres. We set up the plant with help of Neeri. सारे बगीचों को पानी वहाँ से हम supply करते हैं अभी. So that must trace on a treated water, a costly water, coming to Mumbai from 130 miles, then treated had so many treatment plants and supplied to you, it cannot be handled and taken so easily that chalo any amount can be wasted. Recycle, reuse, the bahut badi technique hai. STP plant cost crores of tens and hundreds of crore rupees, but it's a very simple technology. अपने गाँव का भी सीवेज पानी अगर खेती में जाता है, कंटेमिनेशन करता है, वेजिटेबल खराब करता है, वहाँ से पेस्टिसाइड्स आ जाते हैं, वहाँ से फंगिसाइड भी आ जाते हैं वेजिटेबल से, और उसको डिग्रेड करे, एब्सॉर्व करे, तो जो ऑर्चर्ड्स है आपकी, जो फूड चेन है, वो कंटेमिनेट नहीं होगी, सेफ रहेगी. तो ये सिंपल टेक्नोलॉजी है, यानी इको विलेजेस में और विलेजेस में हाउस होल्ड पे शुड बी प्रैक्टिस. Though he has talked so much detail about it, it's a great science, but simple to practice, everybody can do it, depending upon what the level is. जैसे problem पड़ता है industry ले, hazardous waste है, तो then the scientist intervention can come, a proper plan, layout, design can be done, and the problem can be solved without any other ecological damages. Thank you. So I invite the organizing lady, Dr. Dhonde, but still we shall control her time, we will not give her freedom. So that at 2 o'clock we go for lunch, shouldn't be delayed beyond that. So Dr. Dhonde, please.
It was a request of Dr. Rajendra Singh ji that I am here, otherwise I was not in picture. He insisted that I should be giving the presentation, so I am giving it here. But of course, this will be highlighting a very different kind of an issue which very rarely we are aware of. And that is the reason it makes very important in this gathering also to be presenting this paper. Because normally when we talk of Ganga, everybody keeps asking me, Madam, kya pollution ka study kar rahe ho kya, wo namami Ganga ke isme ho kya. But rarely anybody knows. And in fact, we were surprised when we were in Delhi conference, Jairam Ramesh ji, who was earlier environment minister, he also expressed that he never knew before we had presented or we had spoken about this, that this is also one of the issue with Ganges, and which is very, very typical, very critical and very serious issue. And since 40 years, there is no solution to this. Hence, since then, there was a realization, and next day, Uma Bharti ji also went to Farakka, and then she also had seen this. That's why we think that in this gathering also, it's important to show this presentation. So you can see this is, sorry. This is the Farakka Barrage. This is a dam having 112 gates in Malda Murshidabad district. There is Farakka, a place or a village where in Farakka there is this dam is there, and it is called as Farakka Barrage, and it's having 112 gates. When first time even I was not knowing about it, and when we went to Patna conference there, when I just heard every time decommissioning, there was lot of talk only going ahead with that we have to decommission this particular Farakka Barrage. But then I came to my mind 112 gates and such a big dam, and for so much of development that this thing had come up, and suddenly we talk of decommissioning, which is not a joke. Hence, we thought that I also was thinking that I should get an opportunity to really go to that site and see what exactly is the issue with it. Because first time I was getting introduced. And I'm very, very thankful to Dr. Rajendra Singh ji, who actually gave me an opportunity to physically go there, do some social assessment and environmental assessment. Again, second time, I went for environmental assessment with the help of two major organizations, central organization, that is Botanical Survey of India, Zoological Survey of India, and NERI, National Engineering Environmental Research Institute. And I was very fortunate to go with this delegation and under leadership of Rajendra Singh ji, and which could actually make our proposal very strong while putting it to government also. And after the study, we have submitted this report to Prime Minister's office, President office, to even Water Resource Ministry. Now we are waiting for some action to happen, because since 40 years this issue is yet not touched, neither any solution has been found for this. So that's the reason we were thinking that in this declaration, this point also becomes very important to be introduced, and strongly we should put certain recommendations so that ultimately solutions can be arrived. Now you can see this part. I showed you this part as the dam, Farakka Barrage dam, and this you are seeing just in front of the dam, this area. This is nothing but the sediment which has come up, you know, in front of the Ganga, where Ganga used to flow there, all these sediments. And you will not believe with the next flights, This is all about what sustainability is all about and how we conceptualize what should be the operationalization, contextualize, and then synthesize about the sustainability. Because we are all today very much, feel like, you know, every time mentioning about sustainability, but under the name of sustainable development, so much development is happening, which is actually by the human beings only, and we are our own enemies as such. Now it is being seen. Hence, now we have thought that with these findings, we have thought the relationship between humanity and communities and the environment has to be built. The ways in which people come to understand those relationships, the responsibilities individuals have because of those relationships. And I'll just go with the photographs only. As sir also said, he will not give me more time, and I also don't want to waste time of everyone. Let us look at what is happening. So I'm skipping all this, but then our intention, our objectives with going with these scientists and doing a social assessment was mainly to understand the impact of Farakka Barrage with regards to silting and erosion of Ganga River basin, to find reasons of changing course of Ganga, explore the causes of sedimentation in Ganga, explore the causes of erosion in Ganga, botanical changes due to erosion and sedimentation, zoological changes due to erosion sedimentation. Let me mention here, one of the Zoological Survey of India representative is also here, and Botanical Institute representations are also here. Let me tell you, when we first time went to these departments before going for this survey, when we went there and they showed us all their studies and all the presentations, but these presentations which were shown, they were somewhere very, you know, old records and data which they were trying to present. When they said about Ganga, there's so many number of species are there, so many number of planktons and many different species and all that listing, lakhs of they showed. But then when I am a very outspoken lady, I just asked whether it is a recent one, whether it is in context to erosion and sedimentation, there was total mum. So then we thought that we should also recommend that there should be a periodic monitoring of all these things, which is not happening. Basically, Ganga is only river where we can find dolphins. And every time there is a dolphin man, there is a dolphin boy, and many things we keep the name, but ultimately they are also endangered in the Ganga. As well as Hilcha fish. I don't know how many people know Pala fish. And it's a very tasty fish. Ganges is more known for that Hilcha fish. And even it's, in the market and all, the number is reduced. And when we had been to that particular area, Farakka Barrage, near that area, manager of the Farakka Barrage wants to say it is not got affected. But when we went to market survey, we did, market says it is affected. But ultimately, it was Zoological Survey of India who could have given us an idea whether it is really affected or not. So then we thought that we will take scientists along with us, and similarly to Nirian Botanical Survey, because even this Malda Murshidabad region is very famous for Malda mangoes. But that market is also gone down because of this erosion problem. So we thought of taking all these people along with us, then to carry out survey of ecological and environmental impact assessment with regards to Ganges, impact of erosion of and sedimentation, then explore solutions for Ganga erosion, then recommend, this is most important, recommend economical and ecological sustainable solutions to curb erosion and sedimentation, recommend solutions for rehabilitation of displaced population. Let me tell you, nearly 4 lakhs and more people are all affected, yet not rehabilitated. Those who were very rich people having hectares of land, they are homeless today. They are staying on the platforms or anywhere. And those who are trying to occupy the places which is got rebuilt through the island kind of formation after the erosion, they are not having any citizenship of any country. That means they don't have any facilities of what we Indians are enjoying, and such lands have become a low man island, and there is no policies, no facilities for people staying on those lands. That means the people, those who already had their lands and it has gone in erosion, it's got submerged, and they occupy such lands, but they have lost all kinds of facilities as we enjoy as citizen of India. And similarly, most of the lands is also going towards Bangladesh, and which is not in record also. So all these things needs to be in our policy recommendations when we are forwarding to the policy planners. I was very fortunate, and I was invited by Patna government, Nitish Kumarji. He gave us a helicopter also to do aerial survey. That was the first time I could see with my own eyes the kind of devastating situation which is there. And I could not believe with my own eyes that this is the condition of Ganga. You can see here, See, Ganga doesn't have a single course. A regular course is there are so many, you can see that course it is changing. And it's only because such kind of sediments which is there all around Ganga. This slide we are trying to show with year wise that the area where we are right now, we are talking about this particular place. You can see how it looks now, and I'll take you through the years how it has got. Oh, that is okay. It may come now. This is the place where we went to Malda, Murshidabad, the affected areas. We did a social assessment. In the social assessment, we tried to meet all local people as well as gram panchayats. There were people, those NGOs. Sir, what is the name of that NGO? Aid. What is that aid? Action Aid. Okay, Action Aid people. So many NGOs were involved there in doing the work, but then still we try to talk to NGOs, then Gram Panchayat, Gram Sabhas, and local SDO, BDOs, and all. And you can see here you can see the land. This is actual the Ganga, but here that is formed as an island. And in that island, this lady, Attabur Sheikh, and wife Jebu Mara, both have tried to put some Bhutta plantation here. Now what is happening in the Ganges, whatever the plantation is also happening, people are doing on their own ways. They are not being guided that what kind of plantation should be done, what can help to stop the erosion, but to just to match up with their livelihood that they are putting any kind of plants and they are trying to be there. Because these people had 40 hectares of land, but they have lost it. It is submerged, so they have become homeless. Now somehow they are trying to grow something here, and it's in the midst of Ganga. Can you believe? And when I had put my picture here, people were asking in which garden you are standing and all that way. But this is actually Ganga where we are standing still, and it's an island where they have tried to do some kind of agriculture. Similarly, we went to the affected areas. We have tried to meet people. We have talked with the people. Then mainly we saw that there are Gram Sevaks and Gram Panchayat heading. That persons are all ladies. And that's a very good sign that I thought that there something can happen there. Then when ladies have started taking initiatives in that region. You can see this cutting of villages. You can see. They called us at Katav. Ganga ka Katav. So this cutting, every time, every night when they sleep, they feel scared that morning they will have their house or not. And I will show why that reason is also behind that. This is next time, second time when we went for, first time it was completely, exclusively social assessment. Second time it was social assessment as well as we did the environmental assessment with the help of the scientists whom we took along. So we begin always with, hearing to the people, because mostly in the research, we go with our own having understanding and some research base. But it's very important and very easy to get feedback from the people, those who are affected. They are much more experienced. Their 40 years experience, we could just make a gist in this and we could present to the government. Because that is the easiest source to get all ideas about what they are going through and what they would like to suggest. And of course, they have actually very good suggestions. But because they are not connected or government, they have been asking, they have been writing letters. But nothing is working out after doing follow-ups and their representations being sent. Nothing is happening. So we felt that we as a third-party intervention, probably people, those who are there as a central institute's scientists and all, they may not be able to put properly to the government, because they always like to show all rosy pictures that everything is good, because they are there for that purpose. But ultimately, if any negative things have to be shown, and if we have to help these institutes, we felt that as a third party intervention, not as an NGO. See, I'm not standing before you as an NGO. I'm standing before you as an academician, as a researcher. I'm not an NGO as such. But of course, I'm totally guided by Rajendra Singh Ji with his very much experience, and his guidance is worth than anything else. So we are doing this, and this kind of third party intervention, and when we take it to the government, then I feel that something constructively can happen. So we tried to study the area. We went again in that particular area. We met all the representatives of whatever the way they are doing the work. You can see here also when we are standing, this is all Ganga, but all filled with, you can see the height of the sediment which is there. I will show you the sediment, the height in the next slides. So all we met, but yes, of course I can see in those area, no, people are very good. They are actually doing excellent job. This is an SDO there, Bhutia. And he's loved by the people like anything. He's trying to put his recommendations to government, but it is not happening. So somewhere our help can help them to, you know, do some good work. So I will show what he is doing. Actual work also I will show. Here you can see Rajendra Ji Singh is standing here. Here they were very much scared that there is a Krishna Mandir. Ultimately, people are not even thinking about themselves. They are so much connected to God. They just want to save here a Krishna Mandir. So they had all gathered here and they invited us to address them that how we can help them in saving that. But let me tell you, recently that has got submerged. That's got eroded. So now these are the situation which is there that ultimately wo Bhagwan ko bhi nahi bacha paaye, aisi halat ho gayi hai. So abhi hum logo ko sochna hai. Now you can see this is, see the way Ganga is flowing. You can see the sediments. Nobody know the situation which is there. Because of this sediment, it is coming as an island here. So Ganga is to find some course and it is trying to flow through anywhere it is getting its place. Now you know that Supreme Court is also given it as a living being status. You know, so we have to understand that agar humko bhi koi haath pao band karke rakh dega, hum kahin na kahin se thod ke nikalne ki koshish karte hai, wahi halat aaj Ganga ji bhi kar rahi hai. So that is the situation. Now you can see this height. This height is almost 12 feet. And here I tell you, this is just in front of the baraj, which I showed you. Baraj bani hi thi pani ka flow ke liye aur pura shipment wagere hone ke liye taki commercially bhi economical development ke liye. Magar agar aap soch sakte ho ki 125 crore se jo dam banaya gaya, wahan aaj na ship chalta hai, insaan hi nahi chal sakte. Hum bhi jab chal rahe the, hum log chal bhi nahi pa rahe the. You can see the halat wahan ka kya halat hai. Aur ये सब एक टेम्पररी वो लोगों ने अपनी तरीके से कैसे भी ये बना रहे हैं पानी का सोर्स बनाने के लिए. और लेकिन आप देख सकते हो कि कचरा वगैरह की भी क्या हालत है. बट आई एम नॉट ट्राइंग टू शो कचरा राइट नाउ. बट एनीवेज वी ट्राइड आवर लेवल बेस्ट. नाउ सी, नाउ आई एम ट्राइंग टू शो यू अ टिपिकल काइंड ऑफ इंडियन सिचुएशन, वाई वी आर नॉट एबल टू फाइंड सोल्यूशन टू एनीथिंग एंड वाई 40 ईयर्स स्टिल एंड स्टिल वी आर स्ट्रगलिंग टू पुट इट टू एंड कन्विंस टू गवर्नमेंट दैट टू फाइंड सोल्यूशन. नाउ वी आर हियर, we can see this person, he is the general manager of that baraj. He is appointed by central government. His area is 40 kilometers upstream and 80 kilometers downstream. That means central government is having its purview and control over, that means of the Farakka baraj. Remaining is by the, here you can see that BDO again sitting here, Mr. Bhutia. Here the SDO Jangipur. Now here is, this is the MLA, that means local representation. This is all government representation, this is state government, and here central government. Now this central government is, when we met manager, he says there is no problem with the dam. All the gates are proper, he took us around, he said, he claimed nothing is wrong. And when we asked that what you are doing about the sediments which is there, did you try to find solution? He said that is not my area. That doesn't come under us, no purview, and we have not done anything regarding it. Can you understand this? Now when we went to BDO, now BDO and SDO, mainly we went to BDO and SDOs also having a very much feeling for those who are not rehabilitated. Now when we asked them that what about the rehabilitation situation, Mr. Bhutia had to say that the people, those who we are trying to rehabilitate, they are not ready to go to the areas which we are giving. Can you understand? The people, those who have lost their area, with those who were staying near the banks and they were doing certain business, they have lost all those things and they are practice, they are having the practice of that only. They would love to stay nearby, but they were being sent to very far areas, so they are not ready to go still. That means that rehabilitation, very few, that too, when we ask those people also, those who are requiring rehabilitation, they say that they have not approached us. And when we go to them, they say that we are trying to, but they are not ready to go to the place where we are trying to shift them. Now this SDO, when we met regarding what they are doing about this sedimentation and erosion aspect, he said, I'm new, but still till date nothing has been done, no report is there about this, but of course you people have brought to our notice, so we will definitely help you out in all these matters. Again, this is the local representation, MLA. He was very nice enough. He also is with us and he's feeling that something should be done, but ultimately nothing is coming out. I'll show why. Now you can see these pictures are showing us right from 1986, 1990, then 94, 98, how the structure went on changing. This is the area which we are highlighting, the Chur, Sujapur. You can see the first 1986, how it looks, Ganga's flow. Then you can see 1990, how this sediment has increased and then how this has become narrow. Here you can see again a situation, it's become more, it has occupied and it is like it has become more narrow on the left hand side. And here you can see the situation, how it is. It has started now. Now you will see that how it is getting bifurcated. That means from center of it. One minute. Now you can see what is the situation here. Again, you see here. Here you see how it has started coming from here. See the course, how it has changed. Now see how it has changed the course. See, all these things are today. Technology has made our life so easy. We can see how things have changed. But still, we are not ready to address such issues, which is very easily available and data can be shared easily to find out the solution. So you can see how ultimately from where now Ganga is flowing. You can see how Ganga is flowing now. Can you imagine? So this is the latest photograph which we could get for the erosion and sedimentation. Now you can see that here same thing I'm trying to show how the erosion. Now central government, typically temporarily they try to put boulders to get safe from the erosion, but ultimately whenever the flood comes, these all boulders, they get washed away. It's not a permanent solution at all. And every year crores of fund, 125 crores first of all to build the baras. Now every year 12 to 18 crores just to make temporary arrangements for or to safeguard the people from erosion. Can you imagine every year? And it is not exaggeration. In fact, me and Rajendra Singh ji saw that copy also, and then we showed it to DM, SDO and everybody when the sanction was there for 11 crores. And we went and saw that 11 crores was also floating in water. I will show that what 11 crores were floating in the water. So that's the reason that we have to see the actual ground realities. Unless the social assessment is done, we cannot do a proper kind of a recommendation to the government, because actually it is their work to monitor regularly and do some constructive thing, but it's not happening still. So I'm trying to show this. Actually, this is really, I cannot believe with my own eyes. See the sediments. Ye baraz hai aapka aur uske samne. Can you see the sediments? I feel every day literally this BSI, ZSI, NERI and all central governments, those who are connected with this kind of water resource department and everybody should go and actually feel that place. Unless you feel, as you can see Rajendra Singh ji, when he says, he feels for people. He feels necessity of the things. That is why he goes to everywhere, and night also he has come at 3 o'clock. Still you can see the energy flowing because he feels for doing something good. So if people go there, they realize then only that feeling comes and then good things can happen. Now I'm showing you how 11 crore goes in water. Now this you can see, actually this picture is not come out nice because we had visited there in the night time and I could click it with at the very night and very dark, too much of darkness was there. This is a concrete porcupine. This is called a porcupine. You know, they are trying to stop that erosion by the help of these porcupine which they have tried to construct. This is by the central government. 1 year back they had done it. Now with the 1 year back, when we try to meet the officials there, they say, and even the villagers, they said that this is showing the result. That means sedimentation in this area is totally stopped and even erosion is stopped. So when this has already shown 1 year back onwards, practically this has shown the result, why then this is not being done today also? Now when we went there, state government is trying to, and 11 crores was sanctioned and the work was going on. You can see these are the bamboo porcupines which are made. And just no officials, no one is there. It is just given to the local, that boatman, to just go there and he just, tilts it. Like, they are 3-4 such porcupines are tied up together and they bring it and they come to this bank and they just tilt it there. And it just stands. Either it stands or it floats. And you can imagine when it is bamboo, it will take 1 year even to get decomposed. And then, it will not stand as strong as it is required to control erosion. So you can imagine this is at the same place. It's not very far distance also. It is just, 1 kilometer away that this practice is going on. And this is under the purview of central government, which has shown the result. When it is shown, it is practiced. When it is showing, why not it should be again replicated? Or why can that good practice can be adopted by state government also? What stops them? And it's a, in fact, it's a cheaper one also, what we realize there. Maybe Rajendra Singh ji may throw more of a light on this. But as a layman, when I think that when it had shown a result, this one, why not that could have done at that period only by the state government. And if they do jointly such efforts, I think good results can come up. And further, there will be no problem to the people staying there. And let me tell you, every day, literally, I'm daily receiving their SMSs, messages, WhatsApp pictures, that erosion continues as we had seen. Till date it is. And you know, it feels so bad. And then they are requesting me every day for getting rehabilitation, some kind of a help, because I have spoken there to West Bengal Department of Finance Development Department and Social Welfare Department. They have also given assurance that they will be helping us, and in that manner that I am still connected with them. Only thing is, I am not able to physically present, because you can see my approach. I am a person, if I go, I will convince, I will push, I will get the thing done, but I am not able to, hence it is getting bit delayed. I'm still waiting that I will make some time to go there, and I will try my level best that if at all anything can be done. Now I'm showing these, I'm not going to go into, delve into detail about these things. These are BSI, some report which they had tried to give us, and when they had come along with us, and some very, I must say it is a shallow kind of a study report which is here, and very superficial one, where still we can see that how the numbers have reduced, and how the species ratio and all what it is here. I don't want, because many of us are sitting here who may not be interested in botany and zoology, but still who are botany and zoology, they may see it here. So some few plants only could be recorded, and ultimately it was seen that the plants which are there, they are not worth for stopping the erosion, and actually the important plants which used to exist, they are no more there. Very few could be listed. And yes, this is a very important one. This is vetiver. This, you can see some grass which is grown. Now this is called as vetiver, and this is the scientific name. Now this is the initiative which is done by the SDO, that Mr. Bhutia. He tried to import this from Japan. He says that this grass is very good at, it's, you can see here written, vetiver plants have very extensive, more than 3 meter in length fibrous root system that could cover substantial soil volume and could hold soil effectively, thereby minimizing erosion. And they can grow at this particular pH, and all these things is written, big things are there. But can you imagine the amount of erosion and sedimentation today we are talking about? And still this is an experiment which is going on, that in our situation how it can acclimatize. Like, we are trying to multiply this plant still, and then we are going to go for plantation of such grass in the bank of Ganga River. So still this is a good initiative. Something is better than nothing. So at least I appreciate that man, and he is a very local and very connected to the villagers, and in the village wherever the things are very complicated, he is trying to plant these plants. Mainly fisher folks are also very much affected. Now we had carried out some agitations and all, and we feel that there should be proper rehabilitation of these people. So ultimately we went to the DM's office also. When we went to DM's office also, like, absolutely very casual attitude of the government representatives and officers. Still they say, हाँ हम लोग देखेंगे, हाँ अच्छा हो गया आप लोगों ने बताया, हाँ इरोजन के लिए हम लोग काम कर रहे हैं, हमारे लोग जा रहे हैं. जब हमने कहा इरोजन के लिए काम कर रहे हैं, तो क्या आपने देखा इरोजन का काम कैसे चल रहा है? और फिर बोलते, ठीक है आपने बता दिया, हमारा एक ऑफिसर जाके देख लेगा. नाउ 111 crores गोइंग इन वाटर, और क्या देख लेगा? पब्लिक मनी पानी में जा रही है, कब देखेगा? These are the questions, but still it is all our responsibilities. Instead of criticizing, we are trying to do our bit, and in that manner that we try to, in fact, thoda sa motivate karna logo ko aur batana kaise wo bhi participate kar sakte. So this is the Gram Panchayat. They are doing lot of good work, but all this work is going, going waste, because government is not putting attention to their cry. Now this is how we compiled with the convention, and again what we are sitting here today, prepared a declaration. Then we try to meet West Bengal's chairman, Water Pollution Board, Mr. Rudra. He also said that he is an activist, and now he is given a chairman's position. He is a big scientist, and they have been doing a lot of work. But again, everybody had to say the same thing, that we have been fighting and still nothing has nothing is coming up. So he has provided me a lot of documents with the support of which I have prepared an ultimate report and we have submitted to Prime Minister and President's office also. So I think almost everything now I have covered and ultimately I have given an idea. But now what we are majorly suggesting here, that ultimately there is a very important initiative required where central government, state government should jointly be sitting and finding out solution to this. A committee should be formed where there should be representation of central, state, local, then the NGOs, experts, and they should try to, you know, do some brainstorm and find out solution. It's not that there is no solution. I tell you there are solution, and I got a little bit of idea during, actually I may not have added it here. Yes, little I got a ray of hope when I had been recently in the Delhi conference and some IITians, they had shown us some their models of dam, how it can be made or how modernization can be done in the dams where the flow can be made better and sedimentation and erosion we can get rid of. So with that presentation, there was a piano key model which was shown by Dr. Nayan Sharma, IIT Roorkee. I felt that was a very cheaper model, 25 lakhs, where we will not require every year crores of funds to be going in water. But with that modernization, such things can happen. So in our declaration and recommendation of Delhi conference, we have added this model along with, we are not trying to say that you do use this model only. We are trying to suggest one of the model which we feel better. And we have said that they can look into other models also which are available. Not only available, but they have been installed and practiced and results are very prominent. Like this piano key model has been put up in Himachal also in an Indian context. Then in Vietnam, having this number of gates of the dam, that it has been practiced. So I think that nothing bad, if we can waste 111 crores, why not 25 lakhs again? Just to have a understanding whether that model will work for us. So with this, I feel whatever I wanted to show to you all and I have been able to present and show, and I feel with this presentation you all will also understand that though we are sitting in Mumbai, we don't understand issues of this kind. Of course, I'm doing work on Bhadsa River and over damming issues. On Bhadsa, there is another Mumri dam which is coming up now where we don't require so many dams. Mainly I'm trying to emphasize Dr. Rajendra Singh ji to put in policy also that as every government, one to every government has its own policy different way. Like in our government, whenever we have water crisis, we try to recommend for another dam to be built, and without having an understanding that these dams are also affecting our biodiversity. There is no record kept before the dams are being constructed, and major issue is of the over damming is there. Of course, as I have said, that these over dams have to be stopped. Another thing is we have a policy since 2003 about rainwater harvesting to be made compulsorily implemented for all the new buildings coming up. And OC should not be given, in the GR it is mentioned, OC should not be given unless there is a water harvesting system is there. But still, till date, my own survey, not zero, zero, not 0.1% also it has not been done. And OCs are being still given. The government who gives this or they comes up with the GR, they themselves are not monitoring whether it is effectively implemented. Though there is a special cells also, centers have been created, rainwater harvesting cell in the BMC. Still those cell, when you ask them, they themselves will refuse that yes, nothing is going on. But then nothing is going on then for what you are being paid, what you are doing as a responsible person and office of the department. So we have to highlight all these things. Again, I would request that regarding interlinking of the river and all these issues which are there, they should be taken up. And with this, I will stop here. Thank you very much for giving me an opportunity.
Thank you for finishing in time as promised by you. Exactly the 2 minutes past two, before we break for lunch, we must thank all the speakers for this session. And last one, to make a comment on that, it is a very sincere effort of preventing this problem or continuing the silting and erosion as well. This is the problem of most of the dams, that once we construct them, we don't bother about the health of the dam. We plant the trees, the city, roadside, everywhere, we don't bother about the health of the plants. And the policy making, as he said, the water conservation in the cities, rainwater harvesting. Well, those who can take it seriously, they do it. Policy helps in that sense. But it doesn't work in 100% kind of a solution that we plan for. So we must take a cue from this. Lot of remedies, the government actions, interventions for stopping the erosions and all that, community participation, things are very difficult to move, get them implemented, and finding the solution which are till something like a scientific, like she said, IITians have provided some solution, it can reduce this impact. Friends, will have to struggle around based on the local situations of every issue, every dam, and every situation that we have been talking about, whether water harvesting or is excess water, as Savkar said, that could be taken to the drought-prone areas, or the surface water, which is the water sort of catchment, has to be kept as good or healthy as possible, avoid contamination. So this the plenary session, I would say plenary talks rather than the session, have highlighted the issues for which we have been thinking how to put them into perspective plans, and every effort, scientific interventions or the developments and the models have to be evolved, taking a cue from the problems on one side, the solution from the other side, like Govardhan Eco Village is one of the solutions to move this movement to a countrywide, you know, and how to protect ultimately our rivers, water, one of the Pancha Mahabhutas in a sense of what we are thinking of for sustainable development. So with this, are you giving any mementos to speakers? You have received here, already given. So okay, if not, we can recover them later on. So any comment, Rajendra ji, want to?
This session was important tha aur diverse tha. Tino ne jo pani se jude hue sawal hain, un sawalon ko bahut acche se address kiya. Isliye मैं बस सौकार जी जरा आइए. मैं तीनों वक्ताओं को धन्यवाद देता हूं और धन्यवाद के साथ साथ मैं इतना कहना चाहता हूं कि ये तीनों जरा इस लंच के बाद, इस लंच के टाइम में एक साथ बैठकर इसका जो फ्यूचर डिक्लेरेशन है उसमें क्या क्या मुद्दे कैसे बनते हैं उस पर काम करें, और हम अगला सेशन सही 3 बजे, 3 बजे ठीक है, सही 3 बजे शुरू कर देंगे. अगला सेशन बहुत इम्पॉर्टेंट है जिसमें हम सॉल्यूशंस पे जाएंगे. अभी ये जो तीनों प्रेजेंटेशन थे, आज की जो सिनेरियो है, टुडे द सिनेरियो पानी का, उस सिनेरियो को ज़्यादा प्रकट कर रहे थे. वो सिल्टिंग और इरोजन को कह रही थी, वो पॉल्यूशन के सॉल्यूशन बता रहे थे. वो तो पानी के बड़े विशेषज्ञ हैं, तो बीच बीच में उसमें लिंकिंग, वो क्या कहते हैं उसको, फिलर दे रहे थे. और इन्होंने जो हमारे जियो हाइड्रो साइंस है, धरती का पेट, मैं हिंदी में बोलता हूँ, धरती के पेट का बड़ा ज्ञान दिया, और बदले हुए धरती के पेट को ठीक करने का आगे सुझाव दिया. इसलिए दोस्तों, मैं इन तीनों वक्ताओं को, और स्नेहल बहन ने जो इरोजन और सिल्टिंग का प्रॉब्लम है, वो केवल गंगा का नहीं, सब नदियों में हो रहा है, उस पर बात रखी. और ये जो नए डैम, ये सचमुच डैम है, ये डेवलपमेंट के डैम हैं, डेवलपमेंट को डैम में बदल देते हैं. तो ये हमारी खोपड़ी का डैम है, ये जो स्नेहल ने अपनी रिपोर्ट में प्रस्तुत किया कि हमने कितना खर्च किया था,
कितना इमेजिनेशन था फरक्का बैराज के बारे में, लेकिन उसके सिल्टेशन के कारण क्या स्नेरियो हमारे सामने है कि हमें ये कहना पड़ रहा है कि इसको तोड़ो, डिकमीशन करो, सब राज्यों में डिमांड है। ये उसकी जो दिशा है वो दिशा बताती है। इसलिए दोस्तों हमें ज़्यादा समय नहीं लेना चाहता, पांडे जी को जरा हम लोग ये गेस्ट ऑफ ऑनर आप दीजिए ना, एक पानी का विशेषज्ञ पानी के काम वालों को दे रहा है। हाँ, चलिए, बहुत